You're listening to KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. It's 2 o'clock and time for About Health. All right, good health, and welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Norg. I'm glad to be back with you today on the next to last day or next to the last day of the new year. Hopefully you are having a good holiday season. Certainly, it's a festive time for reflection, though, time to think back on what was good about last year and what you'd like to see good about this year. Today we don't, our special guest could not make it due to some travel arrangements, and so will not be with us today, but maybe we'll get him back next week. So it's going to be us again today talking about health, talking about issues that are important to you. This is always a good time because this is the time of the year when we can look back and see what happened in health. Well, what's different between December 2013 and December 2014 and what you're looking forward to. In addition, we haven't had a completely open line for a while. For those of you who have had issues, things you wanted to talk about, who wanted to discuss topics that we didn't get to, or who just simply don't want to make a statement or a comment, this would be a good time, as long as it's not as long as it, but hopefully it's focused around health. I have reviewed for your edification a group of stories over the last year, which have composed the best health stories of the year. And while there are some similarities, there are some obvious differences and some obvious, even more obvious omissions. I think that everybody who looks at these lists, I think, kind of defines health in a very narrow fashion, not the way we try to do it here at KPFA, in a more integrated fashion. And so that the lists tend to be more eclectic, a little bit more scientific than pragmatic. And what seems to be left off the list is some of the focused violence that creates the stress that we're seeing in our cities and we're seeing in our communities around just violence in general, and certainly violence toward young black men and toward people who are different. And so I think that that is, to me, one of the major health stories of this year, but I don't see it on many of these lists that you see at the end of the year around the best health stories. So I want you to make a contribution here. I'm a little, my 5 grandchildren were here over the holidays, so, you know, I'm kind of hung out. Not hung over, just kind of hung out with them. Loved to have them. It was great to have them. But when you know, it's funny about children. You have to be ready for them. I mean, I think if you're raising them week to week, that's one thing. But if you all of a sudden start dealing with them, you really have a major issue to try to get ready. And so I think that puts me in a mood to be willing to share the stage with you if you talk about issues you think were significant this year, issues that are happening to you, things you'd like to talk about in the future. So the number is 848-4425, 848-4425, or 1-800-958-9008. And so if you look at these, some of these stories in years, of course, one of the most puzzling things to me is that how quickly we forget. Obviously, in my estimation, the Ebola epidemic was a number one story, no question about it. The outbreak in West Africa that resulted in 18,000 people infected and more than 6,000 deaths as of December the 8th. It seems that when we were personally threatened, that meant when we were felt that Ebola was next door to us and would be in our neighborhoods tomorrow because of all the 4 or 5 cases that came across last year, we were much more engaged in it. But I told you, over the weekend, I've been out and seen three stories about the Ebola epidemic. It didn't seem to affect the United States of America. I didn't see hardly any stories on the Ebola epidemic. But that epidemic still rages. It still poses a threat. It's a worldwide pandemic. While it doesn't seem imminent in the United States, it's still a major threat. Yet I have not seen one story this weekend about Ebola. I mean, they're all about the plane crash, of course, and other things that have happened. But Ebola is still with us. If you want to talk about this epidemic and our attitude to it, we thought that Ebola's going to move in next door. We were all up in arms about it, willing to work it as partners with the rest of the world and to try to solve this epidemic. But I'm afraid that now that we feel we've got it under control in the United States, we don't have to worry too much about it with regard to the rest of the world. But I think certainly the Ebola story is one of the number one stories. The other thing is that you probably won't recognize, what most doctors recognize, is that I don't know how to present this issue. But I am convinced in this country, and I may be wrong about this, and you can object to this if you want, that we are so now getting so overregulated, it's difficult to do almost anything. As a clinician and a physician, we are now regulated at 5 or 6 or 8 different levels. And while I think regulation is a good thing, I think that the whole regulation business is getting out of hand. And there was a debate around the American Board of Internal Medicine about the maintenance of certification examination that physicians have to take every 7 years. And most physicians registered despite complaints about the process. And then more than 3 months later, the American Board of Internal Medicine decided to ease the requirements. But I think that some form of maintenance of certification, some form of following up on things that happen, so that we can keep up with new things is important. But I believe that it's just kind of become an industry, a cottage industry for regulators. And I think that we're really going to have to start to look at ways in which we can assess competency beside these long-term, and costly and very disruptive examinations. I'm for maintenance of certification in some form, but not from what we see. I think we saw this year, and you may have missed it, the world's first baby born after a uterine transplant. I think that that is a significant development, and it just poses a vision, a window into what you're going to see in the future. This was a situation where a 36-year-old woman received a uterine transplant from a live donor, gave birth to a healthy baby, according to this article. And this has been going on. This has been looked at for a number of years. But this poses, I think, for me in the back of my mind, and maybe for you, a little more forwardly, some ethical and medical questions. But I don't think that story got as much play as it should have, based upon the issues it poses. I mean, if we can transplant uteruses, we can transplant just about any organ system. And the question will be, will the rest of the body be ready for the transplants that we can have? And who will get these transplants? So there are a lot of issues around that. So if you want to discuss anything, stories that you think we're missing, 848-4425 in the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008. We got a small token response to our request for your involvement. The couple of questions, let me give you the numbers again, 848-4425 or 1-800-958-9008. Let's go to Alex in Hayward. You're on About Health.
Hi there, Dr. Lenore.
Hey, Alex.
Thank you. About health, it's one of the most important subjects, you know, in our lives. And the web is so full of misinformation. And for people not familiar with the web, that is not always correct. That can be detrimental and heavy duty. If you don't go see your doctor, you'll be doing the wrong things, perhaps. Well, my proposal would be to correct that, and I think it's very viable. If there was a website like Mozilla example or whatever that people could go to, because it's been fact checked, all the information, and it'd be simple enough to do with all the people that Google hires. I mean, you know, it's a mega society over there. I think it'd be very viable and a worthwhile endeavor for some entrepreneurs out there. But what do you think about that?
No, I think that only 23% of the health information on the internet is accurate. And
wow.
What happens is, you know, I think people start to live in those social spaces, and they actually believe that they are members of the social community, and that the social community has some of the same dynamics as regular communities. I know people whose whole lives are in the social space. Their friends are in the social space, even though they've never seen them. Their information comes. The information of their thoughts are in the social spaces. I think in health that can be particularly dangerous. I've seen more recently some patients who've come in and have made some changes to the child on the basis of clinical information they had about their own children, and made some changes based upon what they read on the internet. Some of those changes delayed more proper treatment. Some of those changes were dangerous. Now, I'm not saying that happens in the majority of the cases. It probably does not. But I do think that we need more vetted sites. Now, there are some sites, and there is some move, afoot to do exactly what you say. To say this is a site that's been vetted by so-and-so. And when you look at a site, you really do have to look and see who is putting up this information. Because if you don't do that, then you're going to be stuck in a situation where 77% of the time, the information is going to be wrong. And so consequently,
yeah,
I think you're right. We need a better way. I don't want the internet to be cooking. It was just like the first question I discussed is the overregulation of everything by people who, many times people who are not even involved in the things that they're regulating. But I do think that you have to be careful, and I think your idea about vetted sites is so critical.
And we are the opposite of China, exactly the opposite. They don't let any information in, but we go ahead and let everything out. And it's a race for advertising is what it is. They want to put those little, the 10 most famous celebrities with an illness. I saw that today.
Right.
And it's just sensationalism, just like the Ebola thing. That was so sensational at the time. Now it's passé. Who's going to really read? That's your thinking. Who's going to really read? But we need the next big thing. Well, we need the next thing to make a big deal out of it. And that's unfortunate.
No, I agree with you 100%. We really are in a situation where there needs to be much more scrutiny of the kinds of information that people get, because people are making real decisions on the basis of some very frivolous information. And I agree with you. I think that's a good suggestion. All right, 848. Well, thank you for suggesting that. 848-4425, 1-800-958-9008. Let's talk to Greg in Palo Alto. You're in About Health.
Hello. Thanks for your program. A couple of things. My experience over the last year has led me to believe that although it's beating a dead horse, that we need single payer, which would include every kind of coverage, including dental, more than ever before. I just wanted to add, I don't even know if this deals with regulation, but it's something about what the prerogatives of a patient are when they go in to see either a doctor or a dentist. And I just relate this. I know you're in the medicine field, not a dentist, but just to give you sort of an example, I recently went for an examination at a dentist's office, and I've had a lot of x-rays, and I'm very familiar with the whole issue of x-rays, having read a fair amount on my own. And I don't know if you know of a man by the name of John Goffman who wrote the definitive works on the effects of ionizing radiation. Anyway, the point was that I went in and I was hoping to just get an examination. The dentist indicated that I would need to get x-rays before he would even look at me. And I explained to him, you know, look, I've been exposed to a lot of x-rays. This is my view on x-rays. Can we limit it to like bite wings as opposed to a full? No, he wouldn't do it. He just refused. And so the option he gave me was get the x-rays, no examination. So I run into this also with doctors too. I mean, it's not just the dentist. I just think that's deplorable. I mean, not to take into account the concerns of the patient and try to see if there's some way to work around that. And I don't know if that I'm just hoping that before I leave this planet, I'm going to see single payers. So anyway,
I think your point is very well taken. I think dentists are in a unique position in the sense that they, a lot of times, what you see on the surface very seldom reflects what's going on underneath. And I'm starting to see some changes in this sense that if you go to one dentist, then you go to another, then you go to a third, even if they're just referrals, that they can use the x-rays of the first. I mean, but I think that they are at a disadvantage in this. And maybe dentists should call and tell us why they need so many x-rays. I want to have my teeth cleaned. And I just want to have my teeth cleaned in the neighborhood because my dentist is somewhat, my regular dentist is somewhat far away. So I wanted to get my teeth cleaned. But he wouldn't clean my teeth without an x-ray. And so I just left. I mean, because all I wanted was my teeth cleaned. Now, that wasn't an issue of what was going on from a periodontal perspective. That was really more what was happening right in front of him. But I do think that maybe dentists can call and explain to us why we need to have these incessant x-rays all the time, even if you're going from one dentist to a dental specialist to somebody else. How much danger does that pose, really? Go ahead.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to.
This is your program. Anytime there's an interruption, it's me interrupting you.
What happened, unfortunately, I left, and it was a very cursory examination. He really didn't do. And actually, what he wanted to do, he wanted to clean my teeth. And I made it really clear when I went in, I wanted an examination. That's what I wanted because I have some problems. I think my approach to this would be, do an oral visual, physical examination. And then if you think you need more, then take the x-rays. But I wouldn't start out by saying, look, I got to take the x-rays, then I'll do an examination and end up doing a cursory examination. I just think it's wrong. And I think that I don't think both the medical profession or the dental profession really understands how much these different modes of examination, like CTs or whatever, are exposing people to and making their patients familiar with, look, this is the amount of exposure you're going to get. So that you can be informed about this. Actually, I'm a little bit ashamed of myself in the sense that I just didn't get up and say, you know what? I'm not going to do this. If you feel you have to do this, then I'm going to do what you did with the guy who wanted to clean your teeth.
Yeah, I did the same thing. I said, look, I'm not going to get an x-ray to get my teeth cleaned. And I understood his position, but I think it's more, I think it's becoming, I don't remember having to do all of this before, I got a cleaning that I needed to have x-rays every time by a familiar dentist. So, but anyway, thank you for that call, and I appreciate that. All right, let's talk to Dr. This is Dr. Kangas. You're on About Health.
Yes. Hello, doctor. You raised the question of violence, and I read this great study in a book called Dead Doctors Don't Lie, and there's a section in there by a professor, Gerhard Schrauser, from the University of San Diego. This study was found that there's one county in Texas that has almost no crime. And so this Gerhard Schrauser went down there and tried to figure out why there's no crime in this one county. And what he discovered was the county, he looked for a long time before he figured it out, the county sits on the largest deposit of lithium in the United States. And so consequently, people frequently... they get a lot of lithium in the eggs and the vegetables and the fruit they eat from the soil. And so consequently, there's almost no violence, stabbings, domestic violence, nothing like that. And I think that if we would put lithium in the water of society. We could eliminate about 50% of the violence in society, because most people, and I've worked with in the criminal justice system for about 30 years now. Well, most of the people that I've interviewed in the process are people that are simply using too much alcohol, too much drugs, too much sugar especially, and they're real short on lithium. And there's a good test in that book on how do you test for lithium, a real simple test. And if we could encourage parents to go to a health food store and get a bottle of lithium and give it to their kids, it could eliminate a lot of the crime and violence kids get into. I mean, that's you've probably heard of this book, Dead Doctors Don't Lie. It's about by Dr. Joel Wallach.
All right. Well, thank you very much for that contribution. I appreciate it very much, and an interesting idea. All right, 848-4425 is our number in the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008. We have a couple of open lines. I'm going to continue through some of the stories that I think have some traction. I think one of the things that you recognize now that the Affordable Care Act is probably going to be under a little attack next year with both in a Republican House and a Republican Congress. And one of the things they're going to probably attack first is these subsidies. You probably realize that in November the Supreme Court agreed to settle where the people who bought health insurance through the federally funded exchanges can receive tax credit subsidies. Because of what has been described as an error in the wording of the Affordable Care Act, only subsidies for insurance purchased on state-funded exchanges are spelled out in the various lower court cases. Subsidy defenders have argued that the legislation intended to include the federal exchanges, while the ACA critics contend that providing the subsidies in these exchanges was an invalid implementation. Well, if you look around, the subsidies, I think, are very much the backbone of much of what the ACA is all about. And so I think that if you look at how things are being done and how many people do have subsidies from the federal exchange, unraveling these subsidies could be a real blow to how the process works. So look for that piece of legislation as we go along, and look for changes in the Affordable Care Act, or attempted changes in the Affordable Care Act. Very subtle changes in ways that you probably don't even recognize would have tremendous implications. I have to see it this way. I have to see the Affordable Care Act as a stepping stone to a better system. Certainly we don't want to go back to the proprietary system that we've had, even though this is still an insurance system. But I think it's a small step on the way to a single-payer system ultimately. I think that that's just how I view it. But I think that now that it's in place, people like it. Many more people are insured. Many more people signed up this year, and the process was relatively flawless in many instances. I think that very small changes in the law and very small changes in the ACA process can have tremendous, tremendous impact on what happens subsequently to those people affected by the law. 848-4425 is our number, the 510 area code. You want to talk about the Affordable Care Act, let us know. The internet's been brought up. Lots of things out there for you to think about and to make a contribution. I have a question about as we march toward 2015. What is our healthcare system going to look like? What are we going to be doing differently that we're not doing now? All right, let's go to. I think we're going to Jeff now in Concord. You're on About Health.
Hi.
Hi, Jeff.
How are you?
Good.
Great. Okay, so here's a kind of a story that I think didn't get enough attention this year, and that is that the CDC apologized for the fact that this year's flu vaccine was deemed to be 100% ineffective.
Right.
And what's interesting about that is despite their doing that, all of the local markets, drug stores, and everyone else still has this massive campaign of signs up all over the place urging people to get their flu shots. Most doctors are still recommending it, and there's been no push in any organized way that I could find to stop that insanity. So I actually printed up a bunch of flyers that quoted the CDC's apology, took them into the local Kmart and taped them up over the signs, and of course got myself thrown out of the store, which is what I expected, which was actually kind of fun. I actually had a good time doing that. But I just, on a serious note, I wonder why doctors are still recommending it, even though it's been deemed to be 100% ineffective. And, you know, what can we do about this? This is nuts.
Well, you know, I think one of the, you know, I'm in favor of vaccines under ordinary circumstances, but this time I have to agree with you. I really don't think that most people, if you walked around and asked most people about the flu vaccine, they'd never heard the story. And you're right. I mean, it does. They didn't say it was 100% ineffective. At least I didn't see the 100% figure. Mm-hmm. They said it's less effective than it should be. And I guess that then leaves room for the something is better than nothing situation. But I agree with you. I mean, I think there should have been more more publicity about the fact that this particular strain of flu is not as effective, and that you need to be doing other things, you know, simple things, washing your hands, staying away from sick people, staying, not going to work when you're sick. And you should have been able to use those techniques that we know can be helpful. There should have been more information about the use of Tamiflu. And if you do get flu-like symptoms, and you're starting to see whole, you know, groups of people get these symptoms.
Right.
And so I can't say anything in defense of this particular tactic. I mean, I think that you're right. There's still encouragement, and I think it's under the something is better than nothing approach to the vaccine. So
I have to say, and I appreciate your response on that, and this isn't, you know, against you or anything, but I have to say that I've been a health researcher for about 35 years and have access to a lot of information that I see reports that other people just don't see from all over the world. But I have seen reports that indicate that the efficacy was close to zero, really close.
Yeah,
and so it calls into question whether the risks actually outweigh the benefits. I would say they do in this case. And I wonder why there isn't more promotion of just raising people's vitamin D3 level, for example, which is very protective. So that's just, you know...
And those are two very good points. We've long been the a proponent of the reality that vitamin C is a very important and dynamic vitamin that people should take seriously.
Right. And vitamin D3 as well.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for that. I couldn't agree with you more on the basic principle that it needs to be more widely you know, acknowledged that this flu. I was surprised when I saw the warning, and it was relatively innocuous. It wasn't a big deal, but I think it should have been, and I agree with you 100%. So thank you, Jeff. All right, let's go to Menlo Park and talk to Henry. You're in About Health.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the program. I just wanted to continue briefly on the comments about dental x-rays and vaccinations.
Right, okay.
I think if the gentleman who called earlier who was so afraid of occasional dental x-rays took a minute to look on the internet, he would find that modern digital x-rays give you typically about the equivalent of less than 1 day's exposure to x-rays that you and I all get from walking around at sea level. So while I agree that we should minimize our exposure to ionizing radiation, I think it's absurd to be concerned about getting an x-ray once every year or so.
Yeah, you know, I don't think that was really his objection, Henry, if you allow me a little editorial license. I think that you know, I've had the experience. I've been to three different dentists for the same problem. Each one of them has a very digitally oriented, practice. All right, I got the x-ray, the dental x-ray from my regular dentist, and I thought that was reasonable and rational. And it was not before a cleaning. This was because I had some upper dental thing. Then I was referred to an endodontist who then had to take an additional set of x-rays. And then I was referred to an oral surgeon who had to take an additional set of x-rays. This was all within a one-month period. I mean,
you would think that sort of thing. It goes too far, I think, you know, especially if there's nothing, if the images are reusable, then they should be able to use them, of course.
Yeah.
But the other thing I want to comment on is the vaccinations, and I think this is one of the most crucial public health issues that we all touch, in our lives. And I am so disappointed and frustrated that some fraction of the population, and some slice in particular of the KPFA audience, thinks that vaccinating children for preventable diseases is somehow very risky, questionable, to be avoided, and so forth, given the obvious case-closed evidence of decades of the fact that millions of lives have been saved by these vaccinations. And I'll add one more thing. There's another program on KPFA that pushes this sort of nonsense, and I really wish that they would at least have the decency to have some, informed people on their show when they talk about these issues, because it's extremely misleading and a waste of everyone's time and energy to be bombarded by this sort of twisted opinion.
Well, thank you for sharing your opinion. When we talk about these issues like vaccination and others, fluoride is another issue that comes up a lot. My feeling is that people can express their opinions. I think what happens in these programs is that they want me to defend my opinion against their opinions. I've been a pediatrician for a very long time, and back to the age when in training I had seen patients with polio, with pertussis, with measles, mumps, die from these diseases. And I remember that my office this time of year would be full with 60 to 80 patients, and now we see 25 to 30 patients because of the introduction of vaccines that had been studied and have been examined and have passed scrutiny. If you haven't seen polio, if you haven't seen pertussis, if you haven't seen measles that kills, if you haven't seen whooping cough, and if you haven't seen the reduction in the numbers based upon statistics and with a risk-benefit ratio, which is certainly within scientific acceptability, I'm sorry. I mean, this is your program so that you can state an opinion. But I've seen the importance of vaccinations, and I've seen people die from preventable diseases because they really didn't. And it's nothing like holding somebody in your arms, a child in your arms, who dies from whooping cough or who dies from meningitis, who could potentially have been helped with an immunization. But that's what I believe. That's what I've seen, and that's from the core of who I am, especially in high risk communities. That's the way I feel. So thank you for your opinion. Now let's go to Marilyn and Aptos. You're on About Health.
Hi.
Hi.
Thank you for your program. I always get a lot of insight both from you and your callers. I'd like to comment on the major health implications of exposure to radiation.
Okay.
Whether from Fukushima medical x-rays, which, by the way, cause a lot of cancer, or the wireless microwave radiation. The man who called about the dental x-rays, I had to shop around for a dentist and sign a waiver just to get my teeth cleaned, that I didn't want x-rays, and so that's how I was able to have my teeth cleaned without x-rays. The caller referred to Dr. John Goffman's book. It's called Poison Power, The Case Against Nuclear Power Plants, and it came out in 1971. And there's one chapter called Is Any Amount of Radiation Safe? And their conclusion is no. One cell can reproduce abnormally to go on years later to cause cancer. And now we've got the cell phone, cell towers, Wi-Fi, the wireless technology in the hospitals that are all biologically damaging, causing DNA damage, cellular stress, heart rhythms, insomnia, the list goes on. But I wonder, I'd like to refer people to emfsummit.com, where you can see interviews with independent scientists and researchers on the harm of microwave radiation. StopSmartMeters.org, EMR Policy.org. Those are a few. and look up the name Barry Trower, B-A-R-R-I-E-T-R-O-W-E-R. He worked in the British Secret Service in the 60s and 70s with an expertise in microwave radiation weaponry. And he said the Wi-Fi, the cell phones, are the same frequencies and power densities used by the military to debilitate people, to blow up weapons. So, and I'd like to see, this is a major public health threat. And I'd love to see you interview.
Hello? I think we must have lost, so if you want to call back to finish your statement, we must have lost you. All right, let's go next to Greg in Palo Alto. You're in About Health.
Hello, yes, I needed to call back because actually this woman who just called in was addressing some of the issues I wanted to respond to. But I do want to make something clear. The guy who called in about the dental x-rays, and not that we want to get this whole program on dental x-rays.
No.
I would just say to him, look, go read Goffman's material. Okay, he was the expert on this. He worked at UC. He was an MD, PhD, brilliant guy. He wrote the definitive work on x-rays. And his opinion, his final conclusion was, there is no safe dose of ionizing radiation. Now, I have nothing, I mean, I can't say I have nothing against it. If a doctor or a dentist absolutely has to have an x-ray because they need to rule out some problem, okay, then there's no other way to do that, then I might say, okay, that's legitimate reason. But I think before anybody like this other man calls in, inform yourself. Read Goffman's work. It's a little dense, but it's there. And he makes it very clear. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. No level of ionizing radiation is safe. So that's my response. Thanks.
All right, thank you. 848-4425 in the 510 area code. 1-800-958-9008. This is your program. This is your day. If you've got a question, a comment, you want to make a statement, or you've got an issue that you think we should be discussing that we've left out. There were several other news stories here that that made, I think, the top 10 list, then I want you to call back. I think that too often we narrow our discussion to the point where we are kind of afraid sometimes to state opinions, and I appreciate the honesty of the KPFA audience as they seem to be extremely interested in all methods of health, all manners of health, and I'm proud to be involved in this type of program. Don't always agree necessarily, but don't have to, but at least we see an audience that really informs itself as much as it can about health. And so this is your chance, your time to discuss the issues in health that you thought were important. Let's go to Hayward and talk to Alex. You're on About Health.
I have an addendum to my last call. You know, in this country, we shake hands with everybody. That's custom. That's American custom. It'd be a great dissertation for someone to figure out which countries don't shake hands, which countries do as a rule, and see the difference in health. You know, who has more colds and thus lost work time lost. That said, the new generation's coming up to where the fist pump is coming into vogue, and which is great. And I'd much rather fist pump an old lady, and I'm an old man, than give her a handshake. Because it gives me the heebie-jeebies when I see somebody coughing into the hand and then they want to shake hands with me. It's like, oh, man, and then you have to do it. Well, I think if the government put up a campaign, if you will, with billboards, blah, 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 that says, hey, this is the new handshake. Because the new generation's coming up and we get them indoctrinated, if you will, to everybody fist bump, I think in 20 years we have a new cultural addendum to us. And it may even go worldwide.
Well, yes, I know. I'm on a hospital quality committee, and hand washing is kind of the key issue. So that you make a good point, Alex.
I've seen some people that come out of the restroom and don't wash their hands. Right. I mean, it's just so gross, but factual. And then those people go into a meeting and shake hands with everybody, and those people, they can't get up and wash their hands like I prefer to do, or you always use the gel, which insults that person. And then you rub your eyes, because it's an hour-long meeting. You rub your eyes, you rub your nose without even thinking about right. it. Well, boom. And not just colds. There's so many communicable diseases, not just the colds. And that's all I really wanted to say, Dr. Lenore.
You remember an old song by the, I'm trying to think of the name of the group, but anyway, keep talking about the president won't stop air pollution. Said, put your hand over your mouth when you cough. That will help the solution.
Oh, yeah, the Staple Singers.
Staple Singers, right. So when we talk about things that we can do, that's what I'm saying. When we talked about the warning against the flu vaccine, there's some things that we can do that have nothing to do with vaccines that will help keep us safe. All right, we've got some open lines, 848-4425, 1-800-958-9008. I always wanted to talk to the KPFA audience about the issue of whether or not you think that we give non-traditional medicine a pass, that we don't give traditional medicine. By that I mean, are we more likely to believe like a Dr. Oz or someone who has stuff? Well, Dr. Oz may be a little bit better because he does present some justification. But we see people who, and their first statement that they make is, well, your regular doctor is not going to understand this, or is not going to be open to this treatment, or regular medicine doesn't do this electric stimulation thing. When we have guests on our program, I don't challenge them on that because that's not my job. My job is to present a point of view and then let you decide where you want to take the program. But sometimes I sit here and I listen to some of the experts that we bring in here, and they have non-traditional techniques for helping people and healing people, but nobody ever challenges them on the science of it and ask them, where was the study, where was this or where was that? Yet if I bring in a cardiologist in here or a lung doctor in here or a pediatrician in here, they get challenged all over the place on the science of why they made these decisions, even in the space of at least FDA approval. So I wonder, how do you feel about sometimes getting information, like the 73% of the information that comes across the internet that is not particularly valid? Do you think we give a non-traditional medical tech healers and techniques a pass simply because intuitively we think that much of the science have been ignored or for whatever reason? I'd like to know what you think. But let's go to Portland and talk to Jacob first. Jacob, you're on About Health.
Hi, thanks for taking my call. It's a great show. Dr. Lenore, I wonder what your thoughts are on a reduced vaccine schedule as opposed to giving children vaccines in the when they're just born and bombarding them and then requiring them come back for boosters. Well, my understanding is that a lot of the vaccines they give on the schedule are not even effective that early on before humans have an immune system. So I wonder what your thoughts are on that.
That's the kind of statement that, you know, and I have respect your opinion, Jacob, but where did you get that information? I mean, that goes against every scientific piece of information I know about vaccines. I mean, and especially when you talk about the Hep B vaccine early on, babies do respond to those vaccines. And we've seen a reduction in all of these diseases. Now, on this particular program, you are entitled to express an opinion.
I'm not saying vaccines are a bad idea. I'm asking what your thought is on giving vaccines once a human has an immune system as opposed to the current schedule giving them when we're just born in the hospital.
See, I'm an immunologist, and your basic babies do have an immune system and a very reactive immune system. Can actually react intrauterinely to some things that they're exposed to. So that basic premise is not quite correct. If we start with the fact that that is not a true statement, then I don't know where we go from there.
So you're suggesting that the vaccine schedule that is prescribed and developed is one that's consistent with the development of the human life cycle and is effective as it currently is.
I am saying that, yes.
Okay, well, I will be sure to look into some more information. If I find anything, I'll be happy to forward it to you. But my understanding is, and I'm obviously don't have the information, that's why I'm asking, is, you know, there's a big push to kind of have a reduced schedule of giving the vaccines once the body is able to developed a little bit more. And so, you know, obviously that sounds good to me, and I'm trying to understand where that's coming from.
All right, no, I appreciate that. I'm just saying that the studies have looked at it, and Hep B is a danger to babies, and that's one of the reasons the vaccine is given so early. But I appreciate your calling and expressing an opinion. That's why we're here. And so please call us again. And I guess, are you an Oregon Duck fan?
Well, I think you either have to go with the ducks or the beavers around here. And I would just say I'm pretty impressed with Marcus Mariota's performance and representing all of us here.
Well, I think he's representing the whole West Coast, so we can agree on that. All right, thank you, Jacob. 848-4425 in the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008. Let's go on to Alameda and talk to Carla. Carla, you're on About Health.
Hi, Dr. Lenore. How are you doing today?
I'm good. Nice
to hear your show. I have a couple comments. One is, why do we even have to touch, you know, regarding shaking hands or fisticuffs? I mean, why don't we just bow to each other? Just do a little head down.
Yeah, okay.
Some Asian countries. That's one. Number two is regarding alternative health. I get Medicare. However, I'm only allowed to use allopathic medicine. I can't use other modalities if I might like to. So if I want to see someone who does traditional Chinese medicine and use herbs, I have to pay out of pocket. I would like to see a situation where we could choose a modality that we want rather than doing something that just supports the pharmaceutical industry, basically.
Well, you know, I agree with you that you should have all options available. And I think that you, if you've listened to our program over the years, you know that we really believe that there are many, many options moving toward health. The only thing I object to is this, is that at times what we do is, if it's not a traditional form of healing, we don't require that it adhere to the same rigors of scientific investigation as we do for other things. There are some things that like acupuncture and herbal medicine and things like that get grandfathered in because they have the benefit of history. That means that, you know, for thousands of years, these techniques have worked. And so that they don't need to justify. They're not required to justify that. And I think I thought you could get some forms of non-traditional treatment on Medicare, but they restrict the number of treatments that you can get.
No, not really. I pay for my acupuncture, but acupuncturist I go to does classical traditional Chinese medicine,
yeah, so,
which is a four-part program. It's acupuncture, it's herbs, it's exercises, and tuina. Diet is very important also, changing the diet. That's not covered by Medicare. I have to take that out of pocket. There are places like Kaiser says they have acupuncture, but it's acupuncture under the guidance of a regular doctor, which is, in a sense, is not really acupuncture because the Western-trained doctor is directing what's done.
Okay, I got you. But I think that things like acupuncture, herbal medicine, and a lot of forms of massage and other things have been used for thousands of years do not have to justify their value. But we do have proposals from people who are doing something just on the basis of the fact that it's considered natural or non-traditional, and they want to get a pass on that because
I'd just like to not have to pay out of pocket. I'm paying over $100 a month for my Medicare premiums, although everyone thinks Medicare is free.
No, we pay for it.
And if I work, I pay for it again. It comes out of my paycheck.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I'm not getting something free. At least I would like to be able to
get
the modality of medicine that I want. And the only reason why I'm mentioning it is because a lot of people aren't aware of it.
No, I agree with you. The NIH, though, now has a Center for Complementary Medicine. And so they are studying a lot of these techniques. And hopefully once these studies are complete, then we'll probably get a revision in that. But this issue came to mind when I watched Dr. Oz defend himself before Congress on some of these dietary issues. And I think to a certain extent, I like Dr. Oz for a lot of reasons, but I think his performance in that situation was somewhat disappointing. But anyway, thank you very much for taking the time to call. And
Happy
New Year to you. You know, one of the things I love about New Year's, you can say Happy New Year to people in this country, and you can be, you're politically correct everyone you say it to. You know, so that we don't have to worry about some of the things that we say, maybe sometimes insensitive to other people who are not celebrating the same things that we do. All right, let's go to Miriam. You're on about health.
Oh, good afternoon, Dr. Lazon.
Hi.
And Happy New Year to you.
And Happy New Year to you.
I'm calling in as a follow-up to the young man, or the person who called in regard to giving children those booster shots as soon as they're born. 46 years ago, I had a son to whom that was administered, and he had a terrible fever thereafter. So when the next scheduled booster shot was offered, I went to see the pediatrician, and I refused to allow him to have it based on the research that I had done, which indicated that it was in the best interest of the pharmaceutical society for our children to be given that, and secondly, that the reaction was not afforded in terms of information to the parents of babies who would receive those booster shots. So I instead used herbs and as well as diet to see to that he stayed well. And he did until he was subjected to a exposure of a child who had chicken pox. And the person who was taking care of the children didn't inform me until my son was infected. However, I corrected it through diet and the use of herbs, and he has never had any kind of reaction to any other infection as a child thereafter. So on two sides, I'm in agreement with you that the boosters do work, but I think the reaction for the average person's child who is in good health is so enormous for the unprepared parent that it makes it hard for them to adjust. And such as, and in addition to that, to consider the environment, the nutritional environment in which the child is raised, which can boost the immune system to protect it against any further disease.
You know, I think you make some very good points, and I think it points out a couple of things. One, it points out that, I think many years ago, this giving a baby vaccinations pretty soon after birth is relatively new, so that was a different vaccine. But the vaccines that were given in the past were the best that they had because of the epidemics that they had all around this country with large numbers of children dying or being affected by polio, or diphtheria, pertussis, and tetanus. Those were the first few. The other part, the thing that I think that you bring up is that we must do other things with our children other than get them vaccinated to protect them from some of the things that they are exposed to. I mean, we got to hand wash. We got to give good nutrition. We got to not send them into places where they can get sick. There are a lot of things that we can do every year for ourselves and our children that will reduce the incidence of illness. And the third thing is that the issue that you explained, that your child was not vaccinated. So that meant that when you go out into the world, that you have the possibility of getting an infection and spreading that infection to other children, because he was not vaccinated. That's called herd immunity. You didn't mention that happened in this case, but it obviously happened in the case of the other child, is that he was not vaccinated either, so he got it, and that may he spread it to other people. So sometimes when we get these vaccinations, we're not just thinking about ourselves or our children. We're thinking about other children who may not get infected because if these vaccinations and when these vaccinations work, you're not spreading those to other people. So I think that's an important issue. But I think that what you say is excellent. We've heard that from several people here today, is that there are other things that you can do to keep from getting infections, to keep yourself healthy, and we hear that all year. I mean, and my year-end statement always starts with the fact that we must recommit to a lot of things. And it seems like the best time for most of us to recommit is probably the worst time. It's right after the holidays when we probably put on as much weight and stopped as much exercise as it's going to take for a whole year to get it back. So that I always use this period of time for, how can I say it, for not only a recalibration, but a reinfusion of the commitment to do better with my diet, to do better with exercise, to do better with some elements of stress reduction, to do better about trying to communicate to other people that I care. Because when we talk about health, positive attitudes in communities are so critically important. And so for me, it's always a time of intellectual regeneration of the commitment to come back to KPFA every year, at least for another year, and to provide you with information that you can use for yourselves and for your families in order to stay healthy. I think we must still continuously remember, and I don't know whether I'm off policy here. I'll probably hear from this in the email. But, you know, any time is a good time to contribute to KPFA. Each pledge period they come and we want to spend an hour or so trying to, get you to understand. I get you. We're trying to explain why KPFA is different. And you know why it's different. But in the area of health, I can tell you once again, and I know you may be tired of hearing this, but there's no other station where you can call and express your health concerns or talk about your concerns or get an answer to a question about your health other than KPFA. And I don't know, and I listen to almost every other kind of radio. Now, you can listen to the doctors and you can go on TV and see various things, but for your personal interest in health, for your willingness to commit to answering a question that you hear from somebody else, to sharing your experience in health, there really is no other station. And so you should always, and I will consistently do this through my programs, and I know it's not the style, but you need to be thinking about contributing to KPFA every time you listen, if you haven't already done so, because this is a station that allows us to do what we do. I have asked you to give me some topics. I have given you my email. I'll give it to you again. It's Dr. Lenore, Dr. Lenore, at drlenore.com. I want you to send me suggestions for guests. A lot of you mentioned people through the year that are people's opinions may differ from mine or that are consistent with yours. I say send me the book, send me the reference, and I'm not getting very many references. I don't know, maybe we don't have very much audience, but in any event, I think this is a good opportunity to say that and to wish you a happy new year. I really want you to remember that that health is your biggest asset. I want to thank Josh and Wes and Felix for assisting me in this program, and also want to thank KPFA for allowing me to do this once again now in the year 2015. I think I started in the year 2000. So, wow, I'm having an anniversary. So for my staff, I'm going to make up my anniversary date, tell you when it is, and I expect a celebration. But remember, if you can, that health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Mike Lenore. We'll talk again next week.
Hi, this is Laura Privis, new program director at KPFA. Thanks to everyone for your generous support throughout this year. KPFA maintains its fierce independence through your support. If you haven't yet chosen a nonprofit to donate to for your end-of-the-year tax deduction, please consider us. It's easy to do at kpfa.org. We are community-powered because of you. Thanks.
Which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on? Which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on?
Need some inspiration? You're invited to the Western Workers Labor Heritage Festival, January 16th through 18th in Burlingame, California, a celebration of the culture of working women and men. It commemorates Dr. Martin Luther King and the struggle for social and economic justice. The festival offers workshops, films, graphic arts, spoken word, and lots of music, and a concert at 7 p.m. on January 18th. This KPFA-sponsored event is wheelchair accessible and benefits the Western Workers Labor Heritage Festival. For more information, go to westernworkersfestival.org.
This is Philip Muldery, host of The Sunday Show. Thanks to everyone for your generous support throughout the year. KPFA exists because of you. Now is the time of the year for making an end-of-the-year tax-deductible donation. It's easy to do at kpfa.org. If you haven't yet done so, please go to kpfa.org today. We are community-powered because of you. Happy holidays.
And you're listening to 94.